Hello and welcome to this short video where we'll just talk a little bit about the global estimate. So normally in ODEON you would set up some sources and receivers in your room and you would find out how the sound will be affected between the source position and the receiver position. Let's just go into the source receiver list and you can see here we have two sound sources and two receiver positions. But for a first fast investigation of the room or for special cases, you might want to look at the global reverberation in the room. So not at specific receiver positions, but more like an average of how the reverberation is in the entire space, in this entire space in here. We will now press the global estimate. You can also find it in the toolbar there, global estimate, and it will start make these calculations. The way it does it is it sends some ray around the room, and instead of then when they've reached the impulse response length, instead of collecting them at a receiver position, ODEON just investigate how much the sound has been attenuated over time. And it does that for a lot of rays, and then it takes an average. Here you can see we're up to 150,000, now 200,000 rays. And when this curves smooth out neatly, and when these values start to be the same all the time, you can say that the average has stopped changing. And then you can derive the results. What you get out is a range of decay curves for the 8-octave bands. And if you press here, estimated reverberation time, you get the T20 and T30 reverberation time, again for the 8-octave bands, globally in this room. So an average of all the positions that the rays has been through. You can then, if you want, you can change the source and see how this will change, how another position will change the, or maybe another directivity, will change the overall reverberation in the room, derive results, and then you can see the decay curves. Here you can see it's still not stable. The values are still, this is the octave bands. Sorry, you can see here the 8-octave bands. Just recalculate again, and you can see again here that this stabilizes. Still changing. There you go. More or less. It depends on how accurate you want your results to be. Again, the estimated reverberation time. Then I would just talk a little bit about another thing you can use this for. And that is that when you set up your room setup, you choose an impulse response length. If this is, that's the time that a ray will be able to run around in the model and make information for calculation. If we set that to 500 milliseconds, the rays will not be as long in the room. And the question is if they are there long enough to actually get the information needed to calculate the reverberation time, and as you can see they are not. And if we derive results, you can see that because the impulse response length is shorter than the reverberation time, then you just get a blank here. There's no information. If we set it up again, room setup, and set the impulse response length to what we believe the reverberation will be, around 2 seconds, and then run again, then you can see that we do get the reverberation time. So this can also be something you do in the beginning of a project to see what the reverberation time is probably going to be around, not exactly, but what area it's going to be around, and then use that to make a proper room setup in here. Then there's this last tab, which is called free path distribution. I'll not cover it that much because for most users this is irrelevant, but for some research projects it's a really good tool. What it does is it looks at, I'll just go out in the room model and see, because if we have a source here, then it will send out some rays, and then it will hit first have one fraction on a surface, but then afterwards the reflection would go here and be reflected here and be reflected here, and between each surface that it was reflected on, so this surface and this surface, there is a length, and between these two surfaces there's also a length, and between these two surfaces, that is, if there's a reflection going this way, there'll also be a length, and then the distribution in here is the distribution between the lengths of these reflection paths between surfaces. So not the first reflections from the source, but then the reflection after that. So you can see here there's a lot of surfaces that is quite close to each other, and there's a lot of surfaces that has this length between each other for the reflections. So it's a little tool you can use for some research purposes. That's what I'm gonna cover in this video. Have a nice day.